the Atrahasis accounts. Igigi was given labor-intensive tasks in southern Africa, including dredging rivers, excavating and constructing aquapipes, establishing communities, and mining gold ore. They were not given female companions throughout their extraterrestrial deployment to Earth, which lasted 3,600 Earth years in Niburian orbit. The old Babylonian versions of the first Atrahasis tablet was translated by Ryan Moorhen. The Moorhen Atrahasis tablet. After completing their task, the load was too great for the gods to bear. The labor is backbreaking, and the annoyance is excessive. The powerful Anunnaki assigned Igigi 7 duties. Enugi is a canal controller, Ninurta is a chamberlain, and Elil is a warrior counselor. Anu, their father, was a king. After capturing Anunnaki territory, the gods chose by lottery. Anu rose into the atmosphere. Additionally, Elil seized the earth for his people. Elil grabbed command of the sea barricade's bolt as well. Enki was given an extraordinarily demanding assignment. Anu ascended to the heavens. The gods of the Apsu, the sky-dwelling Anunnaki, had fallen from the heavens. Igigi was assigned the responsibility. Igigi dug canals. The Igigi excavated the land's arteries and canals to cleanse the rivers. The lifelines of the land, the streams, had to be eliminated. The gods excavated the riverbed of the Tigris. The Euphrates was later excavated, comfortable in the depths. The Apsu of the Anunnaki built their most prominent mountain peak. They carried the added weight for 3,600 years while working day and night. They moan beneath the burden of Earth's disappearance. They complained and placed blame on one another. I'm interested in speaking with the Chamberlain. Request that he relieves us of our labor as well. After summarizing the most important aspects of the first tablet, the Igigi encircle Enlil's tent and demand a break from their arduous labor. Anu, the father of Enlil and Enki, is called to Nibiru for teaching and advice. Enki is urged to assist in efforts to end the unrest in the mines. Until the Anunnaki Council of 12 meets to examine them, offers of temporary work respite appease protesting Igigi gold miners. When Enki and his half-sister Ninhursag create a genetically modified primitive laborer to replace the Igigi gold diggers, the reader will be exposed to evidence indicating Anunnaki's existence on Earth. Existence of Anunnaki evidence on Earth. Exist any indications that the Anunnaki visited Earth? The evidence analyzed included astronomical, technological, documentary, and biological evidence. On the Enuma Elish clay tablets on exhibit at the University of Pennsylvania Museum, the Sumerian creation story is an allegory of heavenly armies whose victories and defeats caused their hosts' planets to form circuits around the sun. In the Babylonian account, the incident is recorded on clay tablets engraved in cuneiform between 1936 and 1901 BCE. According to Sumerian tradition, in about 2000 BCE, Marduk, Enki's eldest son and the national god of Babylonian wars, was at his most potent. It is thought that in an early version of Nibiru's origin story, the planet was referred to as the homeworld. In OBV, Old Babylonian version, Marduk supplanted Nibiru as the homeworld. Although there are minor inaccuracies, the names of the planets and their distances from the sun are generally correct. The Babylonian origin tale reveals a complete comprehension of our solar system, which has since been proved by contemporary science. Perhaps it is only today that our scientific understanding allows us to accept the Babylonian creation epic. As opposed to our present knowledge and acceptance of just 9 planets, Sumerian documents mention 10. There were 10 planets in the Sun and Moon account, not 9. The epic of creation is described here. Mercury and the Sun begin the narrative by plotting to destroy Tiamat. Mercury is sheltered from the Sun's beams as soon as Enki becomes aware of the arrangement. Enki sleeps with the Sun and Mercury. The planet Mercury has insomnia. Enki, an alternative name for Ea, unfastened his belt, removed his crown, and replaced it with his magnificent mantle. Solar radiation has briefly changed Mercury's orbit since Neptune is Enki's planet. Nibiru resided 900 years above the Sun, perhaps trapped in the Sun's orbit. During this period, Enlil was in command. Radiation from the Sun harms Ea, Domkina, and their eldest son, Marduk. With this story, Marduk demonstrates his right to be a descendant of prominent Anunnaki council members. In the sky, the zodiac consists of Taurus, Pisces, and Capricorn. Kingu, the moon of Earth, kept the fate tablet, which was aligned with Tiamat. Neptune withdraws and warns Anshar of Tiamat's rage, which was ignited by the Sun, Saturn. As a consequence, Tiamat's orbital path deviates. Nibiru, Marduk, promises to help disarm the soldiers of Tiamat. The orbit of Nibiru encompasses a constellation of planets, stars, and Tiamat debris. Nibiru is pulled into Saturn's orbit by Saturn's gravity, which has a soothing effect. Saturn gives Mercury and Venus a satellite or moon to remind them that they are connected to it. Seven winds are unleashed by the cyclone known as Inhulu wind against Tiamat. When an asteroid, Arrow, meets Tiamat, it is cleaved in half. As a consequence, Kingu is destroyed. The remaining half of Tiamat's size is sent to the highest point of the sky, where a guard will keep it in place. Due to the arrangement of the water, it congealed into an ocean. The place was allotted to the Enlil, planetary association stands. Jupiter, Taurus zodiac sign, and Enki after Nibiru's route were modified. Zodiac affiliation Pisces, planetary association Neptune. Tiamat once owned the moon of Earth. Numerous hypotheses have been advanced on the origins of Nibiru's capture in the orbit of our solar system. The Enuma Elish must be read in its original form to fully comprehend the intricate creation epic. When our solar system started, Uranus had a stable orbit between Mars and Jupiter, according to this metaphor, Tiamat. Earth had yet to form. Thus, the competition for orbital position started. Nibiru passed by the outer planets as it began its orbit around the Sun, delivering gravitational forces that tilted Uranus. These forces dislodged Pluto from its orbit around Saturn, elevating it to planet status before demoting it. On its way to solar perigee, one of Nibiru's satellites collides with Tiamat, while Nibiru destroys Tiamat on its subsequent orbit. The asteroid belt, now positioned between Mars and Jupiter, was produced from Tiamat's remains after a significant piece separated to form the Earth. The Earth originated as a planet in its current orbit, claiming Nibiru's moon as its own. The Anunnaki creation tale, retold in Babylon every spring, gives legitimacy to numerous current scientific speculations involving the Pacific Rifts and Earth's colossal moon. It is an accidental panspermia rather than a deliberate one. He said that intelligent entities introduced alien species to Earth on purpose. A collision with Nibiru is another idea about the origin of life on Earth. Nibiru is an additional planet in our solar system. It circles the Sun in a 3,600-year retrograde loop, and its apogee is beyond Pluto. Tombaugh found Pluto in 1930, whereas Charon was discovered in 1978. Dr. Robert S. Harrington oversaw the American Naval Observatory until his death. The infrared astronomy satellite IRAS was launched in 1983 in response to Uranus and Neptune's orbital perturbations. Using the satellite, scientists searched for the planet that may be generating the wobbles. According to astronomers, the IRAS has detected an object four times Earth's size. In 1992, Harrington and Van Flunden of the Naval Observatory authored a news release. Based on their findings, they think a tenth planet has been found in our solar system. This planet is called an intrusion planet. Dr. Harrington and Zechariah Sitchin linked IRAS data to the Enuma Elish, an old Babylonian creation story, since they were both acquainted with Sitchin's publications about a tenth planet. According to the IRAS, other spacecraft, such as Pioneer 10 and Pioneer 11, and Harrington concurred with Sitchin that Nibiru exists. Every bit of expertise was used. A planet the size of Nibiru would pass between Mars and Jupiter once every 3,600 years. The Earth's precession has altered due to the pole shifts and reversals produced by Nibiru's close approach. Perihelion may also produce potentially deadly meteors and asteroids. The Earth is teeming with strange items that defy the culture's acknowledged technological ability. Hieroglyphs discovered in the Egyptian Temple of Abydos represent rockets, aircraft, submarines, and even a futuristic helicopter resembling the American AH-64 Apache helicopter. The trilithon stones are found across Lebanon in the vicinity of Baalbek. Why choose the most challenging material when purchasing construction supplies? Large stone slabs weighing at least 1,000 tons. They probably did it because they could, and because it was simple for them. The Temple of Hathor on biblical Mount Sinai was an astounding find. Something weird was occurring inside the gold-formed temple. David Hudson's discovery of monoatomic gold made this discovery possible. These anti-gravity superconductors may have been utilized to transport the enormous stone blocks required to construct temples. In addition, there is evidence that the Anunnaki of a particular lineage ingested the monoatomic gold discovered in conical breadcakes on the walls of Hathor's temple. The DNA of the Anunnaki was impacted by the short orbital periods on Earth. Especially, the closeness to the Sun destroyed the telomeres. Due to the multi-pass annealing process in gold smelting, ingesting monoatomic gold illuminates the human energy body and is a bridge to other worlds. Adding antimony and other chemicals diminished the bulk of the gold and converted it to a white powder. In addition to awe-inspiring solstices, equinox-aligned sun and lunar temples, tens of thousands of Anunnaki tablets and records of intelligent creatures instructing locals in civilizing technologies exist. There are several indications that the Anunnaki visited Earth. Gilgamesh ruled over ancient Mesopotamian towns such as Eridu, Babylon, and Uruk, where Anunnaki astronauts left behind extraordinary treasures. The following evidence is provided. Baalbek departs from conventional engineering standards. Gold mines were carbon dated to around 200,000 years ago when Enki claimed to have lived in Africa. Sumerian baked clay tablets represent the Anunnaki, their goal, and their personalities. The University of Pennsylvania Museum's explanation of celestial collisions by Numa Elish is extraordinarily nuanced and technically accurate. It describes the current structure of our solar system. Even though Pluto was known to the Romans, it was in the 1980s that NASA could accurately identify it. How did they become aware of it? In 1973, the University of Chicago captured photographs of Eridu's baked bricks protruding from the sands of the Iraqi desert. The city and king are confirmed by the Sumerian Kings List. This is the site of Earth Station 1. We were aware of ancient Middle Easterners' difficulties in the early 1850s. Due to Mesopotamian archaeological discoveries, the world is now aware of the sophistication of the Sumerians. Despite the destruction of Ashurbanipal's library at Nineveh, several clay tablets from antiquity were preserved. The Anunnaki maintained records of marriage, birth, and legal agreements alongside historical documents. According to the records, the Anunnaki astronauts were raised to godhead in the cities where they dwelt and constructed ziggurat temples, demonstrating that the Sumerians knew they were not from Earth. In Sumerian culture, aliens were actual individuals who interacted with humans and their underlying genetic structure. Recently, a 9x6-foot compartment was discovered near the Anunnaki spaceport on Sipar. Over 400 clay tablets, grouped chronologically, reveal the Anunnaki's full tale of Earth's journey in the enclosed chamber. The digitalization of tablets has boosted speed and precision. Sumerian writings regarding the Anunnaki were made public when he was at Sitchin. Only now has the information begun to be acknowledged. Atrahasis literature and Sumerian history propose South African Anunnaki gold mines. According to the Sumerian Atrahasis literature, the Anunnaki obtained their gold from Africa. Carbon dating reveals that miners who lived 200,000 years ago and were biologically linked to us worked the old mines. The Atrahasis tells how DNA from the Anunnaki and animals was combined to generate Homo sapiens. According to genetic data, the Anunnaki may have constructed primitive laborers in South Africa near gold mines acquired by Anglo-American PLC. According to the genetic Eve research that tracked mitochondrial DNA, Shimti, Enki's genetics lab, should be the location. The genetic Eve investigation was conducted on the same day and at the same place as the genetic Adam study, which was motivated by the Y chromosome mutation. The intellect of the Anunnaki said that after just 200,000 years of existence, humanity had heard reports of our technical advancements resulting in competent spaceflight. This contradicts the theory that the development of tools occurred gradually over millions of years rather than immediately, as with Sumerians. The Igigi and Enki conquered Earth around 432,000 years ago. Subsequently, working-class individuals interested in gold ore mining followed the Igigi. Due to mining operations in South Africa, the Anunnaki were in a precarious state. The miners revolted near Enlil's castle after laboring in the mines for extended periods under what seemed to be severe circumstances. After establishing a base in the Persian Gulf, constructing Eridu, and failing to extract fine gold from the ocean, the mining operation was relocated to Abzu, Africa, near the Zambezi River. The miners reportedly labored for 3,600 years before retiring. One Sha, coincidentally, equals one Niburian solar year. The Akkadian Atrahasis tablet in the Moorhen collection. Let's go together, Elil. Allah, the counselor of the gods, spoke from the throne. He also interacted with his brother's deities. Welcome. Bring Elil along with us. The advisor and warrior of the gods departed his residence. The rallying call. As a result of his comments, the equipment of the gods caught fire. Their bolts of lightning and weaponry for the god of fire. The relapses started. As they approached the home of the warrior Elis, it was night and the middle watch. The residence was enclosed by trees. When Enlil saw the Igigi miners surrounding him, he returned to his fortified house. Enlil's guardians, Nusku and Kalkal, forewarned him of the unrest around his home. Nusku, Enlil's vizier, issued a surrender order to the miners. His father, Anu, instructed him to seek instruction from Enki. Anu and Enki unexpectedly held a council meeting to discuss dealing with Anunnaki's rebellious lower levels. On the Atrahasis tablet, Enki, Lord of the Apsu, and Anu, Lord of the Sky, are shown. These Anunnaki are the most powerful. Elil made a comment. As soon as she stood up, the inquiry continued. He addressed the mighty deity, saying, "Have they deserted me? Should I engage in this dispute?" Anu informed Elil that Nusku may go outside. Collect intelligence from the Igigi gathered at your door. Nusku addressed the crowd while armed on behalf of Anu, Enki, Enlil, and the Inugi, and inquired about the governor's situation and identity. The instability among the miners prompted Nusku to alert Enlil. There is a conflict among the gods. We've stopped digging. Due to the excessive workload, we are suffering. Enlil wept when he turned to his father, Anu, after seeing Nusku speak on behalf of the disgruntled miners and demand that a miner is publicly fired as an example. Anu raised her voice. What do we have to complain about? He asked his brothers. They were, in fact, working too hard and coping with too much difficulty. Each day the earth shook. The warning signal was loud enough to hear all the time. Gap. Why do we hold them accountable? Enki, Ea, appealed to the gods of his brothers. The effort and trouble were both enormous. Gap. While Belet Ili, the goddess of the womb, is here, let her make the first man. He must carry the load. Belet Ili, the goddess of the womb, has arrived to replace Elil. Let the goddess of the womb have children, and let a man accomplish the work of the gods. Nintu, also known as Belet Ili, may be heard if the most powerful gods are consulted. It is not my role to compel him. Enki purifies everything with his art. I will use the clay he provides. Enki demanded the gods' attention in his message. Every month, on the 1st, 7th, and 15th, I will wash my laundry. As a result, one deity must be murdered. The gods may also be purified by immersion. The clay must be prepared by Nintu. He was a sentient being. He was both divine and human. It will be improved by adding clay. I want to always hear drumming. God should produce a ghost from his flesh and declare it his living symbol. Permit the spirit to continue being so that the departed god is never forgotten. Yes, definitely yes, exclaimed the crowd. The great Anunnaki determines fate. In the Atrahasis, several genetic experiments, mistakes, and catastrophes are described in detail. Anu presides over the Anunnaki conference, at which it is decided that Enki and Nintu, the physician also known as Ninhursag, would create a primitive laborer to replace the uncooperative Igigi miners. After her triumph, Nintu addressed the Anunnaki Council as the newly crowned Mistress of All Gods. To support her achievement, even a mother of children must submit a TPS report to her supervisor. I performed a fantastic job. I have done the task you gave to me. You've killed a god by destroying his psyche. You no longer have to do the laborious task due to my assistance. The victim of your caprice is humankind. Modern civilized nations are aware of genetic alteration, yet it is so widespread that it poses no substantial concern. Good beings who developed space travel have existed at least 450,000 years before human civilization. According to the legend of Atrahasis, they could. This tests the notion of man as a creator. I wonder whether contemporary biologists conduct tasks other than those performed by Enki in his African laboratory. Consider how the Anunnaki believed a sacrificial creature's spirit might be transferred to another. Similar tales concern the preservation of the soul or energy in the underworld. According to the Enuma Elish creation tale, the earth may have been tainted by Nibiru's life-giving seeds during the collision that brought birth to earth. In his writings, Enki maintained that the creator of all life was liable for the seeds of life. So even the Igigi, also known as the Anunnaki, possessed an idea more excellent than that of a deity. Enki felt that the bipedal hominids on the African plains belonged to a distinct species based on Nibiru's evolutionary process. Consequently, the evolutionary boost offered to early hominids was relatively transient. Humanity owes the origins of life to the All-Creator. ancient astronauts' identities and intellects are encoded in our Anunnaki DNA. Enki's genetic seed was the prototypical Adapa, the first person to bear the Anunnaki mark. The reader is aware of a vital truth in light of the absolute age of the Atrahasis tablets, which is believed to be 1700 BCE. After attempting to eradicate any allusions to the other members of the Anunnaki Council in the Torah story, particularly any link to Enki, the Enlilite worldview displays a historical biblical flood as a background. The flood story in Genesis was taken from the Sumerian flood story. The Genesis tale was created by Hebrew priests imprisoned in Babylon. They learned the truth about the biblical flood while incarcerated. Enlil, on the other hand, developed into the ancient extraterrestrial deity they worshipped, which was monotheistic. After all, they were frightened of Enlil's wrath. With more males on Earth, the sons of God praised the beauty of humankind's daughters. It was up to the sons of God to pick a spouse. The Lord said, "My spirit will not fight with man forever, because man is mortal and has a lifespan of 120 years. The Nephilim existed when God's sons married mortal women and bore offspring with them. They were legendary figures. The Genesis account of the catastrophic flood alludes to a different cause than the Atrahasis myth. According to Genesis 6:1-8, the Nephilim married human women, perhaps violating a cosmic prohibition by producing a genetically enslaved person. Enlil disregards this and attributes the deterioration of humanity to men. According to Sumerian mythology, Enlil was enraged by the human uproar and wished to eliminate it. As a result of how evil humans had become on Earth, the Lord could see that every thought that raced through their minds was detrimental. After creating man on Earth, God experienced distress. His heart was splitting inside. The Lord said, "I will eradicate humanity from the face of the earth, which I created." The tale of Atrahasis is comparable to the Genesis account. A casual observer ought to recognize two seeming falsehoods. In Genesis 6:5, Enlil does not produce humans. Enki and Ninmah were responsible, according to the Atrahasis, which predates the Genesis story by 1,700 years. While working in the mines for Enlil's gold ore, are people's thoughts always evil? The principal argument against the Atrahasis story was that people were boisterous and had trouble sleeping. The notion of his arch-rival's prolific progeny rising up against his domination seemed more plausible than it really was. Or was it just too much trouble? Enlil, the biblical ghostwriter, may not have been a knowledgeable scientist, judging by the language he used in Genesis 6:5. The Anunnaki knowledge of good and evil existed and was used by the Anunnaki in Sumerian Eden. This plant has a DNA-level transforming impact on the human mind. Enlil warns Adapa in the Garden of Eden that he will die if he drinks it. Enki refutes this falsehood by assuring Adapa that he will not perish but become one of us, a god. Enki, who reveals the truth, is rejected and symbolized by a snake, while Enlil, who spreads falsehoods and pretends to be God, is represented by a serpent. Enki's claim that Adam died but was aware of his nakedness is false. Enlil did not want the seed of the knowledge of good and evil to be devoured for this reason. He thinks there should be no restrictions on access to higher states of awareness. Enlil's murderous acts were immediately followed by unforeseen genocide. According to the first man breeding strategy, after 600 years, humans became noisy and abundant. Since the year 600, less than 600 years have passed. In addition, the nation became excessively vast and congested. The rural area was boisterous. Enlil felt forced to listen to their concerns as God became irritated. In his appeal to the gods, he proclaimed, "There is just excessive human noise, which keeps me awake at night. The illness Shurupu will spread. This marks the beginning of the all-out struggle between Enki and Enlil. Enki promised Ninhursag that his creation of humanity would liberate the gods from their labor in the African gold mines. He would be enraged if he heard his half-brother Enlil demand the public's inoculation with a disease to eradicate the noise source, humans. In the book, more critical disagreements between the parties will be addressed. Among them were official rank, birthright, and inheritance. The Bible supports the chronology from Adapa's creation 600 years later through Enlil's effort to halt them. This was the age of Noah during the flood. In the 6 centuries of Noah's life, the heavens' floodgates opened on that day. It poured for 40 days and 40 nights. According to Atrahasis, it rained 7 days instead of the 40 days mentioned in the Sumerian account. The period from Adam to Noah in Genesis 5 is extraordinary. Jared is 962 years old, whereas Mahalalel is 895 years old. Could the Anunnaki lineage explain the extraordinary age records, or were they exaggerated? In addition, the Anunnaki imposed a genetic age restriction on their slaves. Consequently, they became clever enough to grasp what was stated in the mines and had a limited lifetime to reduce overcrowding. Genesis 6:3 states that the most significant human lifetime is 120 years. This is confirmed by the story in Atrahasis. Ms. Jean Calment lived from the 21st of February 1875 to the 4th of August 1997, making her the oldest person. She had lived 132 years and 184 days. She differs from the Anunnaki genetic norm by 2 years and 164 days. Despite the diversity of life on Earth, the 120-year genetic engineering objective has been accomplished. Near the conclusion, Atrahasis closely relates to the mighty god Enki. According to the genealogy in the Lost Books of Enoch, Atrahasis was the son of the historical Lamech's wife, Enki and Batanash. Enki's son Atrahasis organizes a human uprising, directing its participants to engage in a non-violent demonstration to shame the rulers, Enlil, into abandoning the Shurupu disease penalty. Enki's intervention was effective, much to Enlil's dismay, and he tightened his jaws in preparation for his next assault on a human victim. Enlil makes the following revolutionary genocidal order. Enlil addressed the most powerful deities. "I'm having trouble sleeping since everyone is so loud. Stop feeding humanity. Make the vegetation so sparse that they cannot consume it. Adad must remove his reign. Iskur Adad, Enlil's son. Stop the flow of floodwater from the springs below. Let the wind blow, leave the earth naked, and let the clouds collect without precipitation. If the harvest from the field was less than planned, Nisaba should stop up her bosom. They'll never be satisfied." Enki performs intercession on behalf of the public and advises them on how to deal with Enlil's hostility in this manner. Enki orders the people to refuse to worship their god and disgrace Iskur Adad to stop the rain from falling on the fields. Again, Enki's intervention is booming, but only temporarily. Enlil begins his complex assault against humanity. To silence them, he sends further sicknesses, sickness, headaches, Shurupu and Asaku diseases beset humanity. As the crop yield decreased, Nisaba turned away from her breast. The fields transformed from black to white. The earth squeezed her teats, and the broad countryside produced alkali. There was no growth, no grain sprouted. Because the womb was too tiny, a baby couldn't leave. Asaku had repercussions for the populace. Before the conclusion of the 2nd year, the storage room was vacated. In the 3rd year, the storage remained unoccupied. Is this accurate? The impact of malnutrition changed the appearance of people. After the fourth year, their erect shoulders sagged, whereas their well-built shoulders sagged. People often appeared in public slouched. Once the sixth year arrived, her daughter would watch her enter. Even a mother would not let her eldest kid pass through the door. At the auction held by her mother, the eldest daughter would monitor the scales. At age six, a mother would examine the scales at her daughter's sale. A guy and a female were both served as dinner. Atrahasis seeks his Lord Enki once again to save himself and the last members of humanity from Enlil's awful onslaught. The two brothers dispute this request for aid once again. Since Enlil is unsatisfied with the destruction and disease he has brought to humankind, he instructs Enki to make a flood to destroy the remaining humans. Yet Enki decreases. With technology like HAARP, the Anunnaki could manipulate the weather, although it is unknown if they were responsible for the flood or whether it was caused by Nibiru's gravitational effects as it passed Earth on its way to solar perigee every 3,600 years. Enlil was tasked with protecting humanity from a tsunami that might have wiped out Mesopotamia and was produced by sliding ice sheets at the poles. The Anunnaki either initiated the flood with a flood weapon or predicted it based on changes in the sky, but Enlil took credit for it to enhance his feeling of power to punish. The odd behaviors and manners recounted in the Atrahasis story about Enlil and his crimes against humankind should inspire fury and punishment. Due to his worry for his son, Atrahasis, and in anticipation of a planned or unplanned flood event, Enki changed the commitment he was expected to make to the Anunnaki Council. Instead of immediately warning Atrahasis, Enki directs his caution to the wall of the Reed House, where his son has found refuge. "Always give me your full attention, wall," Atrahasis is instructed to build a boat. "Listen carefully to what I say, Reed Hut. Destroy the house and build a boat. Save your money rather than purchasing stuff. Your vessel. Like an Apsu, roof it. To block the sun from peering inside the house, construct upper and lower decks and ensure the tackle is robust. The strength of bitumen is due to its thickness. There will be precipitation here. Gap." The sand clock had been finished. For the flood, 7 nights' worth of sand was needed. As was previously stated, rain rained for 40 days in Genesis, but just 7 days in Atrahasis. Enlil is seeking to accuse Enki symbolically of the flood. To do this, he changes the number of rain days to 40, the same number of days granted to Enki. The tablets include a detailed account of Noah's Ark, complete with Sumerian characteristics. The brothers' acts would be contrary to their nature. Atrahasis is the faithful knower of the oceans. He is the one who will rescue humankind. King Shurupak, who was 600 years old, served as a medical facility for Ninhursag, Nintu, Belit Ili, Mami, etc. She eventually became known in Egypt as Isis. Atrahasis remembered the tale that people would buy after he had left the city. Since Enki and Enlil were in conflict and the city was situated in Mesopotamia, he advised that the best way to find safety in Enki's domain was to leave the region and go to Africa, Apsu. After the last ice age, many cultures believe the Great Flood happened about 11,000 BCE. Following the flood, Atrahasis landed on Mount Ararat, the region's most prominent mountain peak, with the aid of an Anunnaki pilot Enki had placed on board the ship. The Anunnaki saw Atrahasis's boat from their aerial vessel and descended to Mount Ararat to investigate the issue further. The Igigi infuriated Enlil when she observed the boat. The strong Anunna made an oath together. No live creature should have escaped. How did anybody survive the catastrophe? Enki cried to the mighty gods, "I did it in spite of you. I ensured the preservation of life by defending it." Enki created humanity from his DNA and rebelled, saving his son Atrahasis from the flood that wiped off Mesopotamian civilization. Enki created humanity from his DNA and defied his brother Enlil's order to murder the primordial workers, saving his son Atrahasis from the great flood that wiped out the Sumerian civilization. This is the story in black and white. Well, baked clay at first.